Good morning, everybody. I'm delighted to be here today, not as a minister of higher education, but as a professor who has worked in the university for over 22 years. And when I was invited to come and give a keynote address, I told myself that I would not give a purely academic address. The reason being that having left the university section to go to development and the policy, I discovered myself. I discovered who professors are more than I did when I was in the university. That there's a lot that go on around us as professors that we do not know. So I told myself in my topic of women education and development in Kenya, I'll put a perspective that only those in the departments of planning may be interested in, and yet it affects all of us because decisions are made internationally for all of us by our leaders, by our heads of state, by the UN bodies that we have created, and hardly do we know that a lot of expenditure is done on our behalf for development agendas that I'd never touch us. And I told myself for once, it may therefore be true that professors and universities are in the ivory towers and they don't know what is actually going on. Because for once, as a minister, I discovered that there's a lot of expenditure by the Kenyan government that as universities we didn't know and we never bothered to know. So I just said I would like to take you through women in education in Kenya, and particularly the challenges and achievements in the context of Millennium Development Goals. Because in the year 2000, during the Millennium Summit, the United Nations had adopted 8 Millennium Development Goals with the aim of addressing what were considered to be the most pressing global challenges. Who decided they were the most pressing? Who decided they were really challenges? Nobody knows. And yet, as universities, you are the brains. You are the ones who should be able to identify and tell us this is the problem and this is where we should be going. Because after all, we say, even when we are doing our PhDs, you must create new knowledge. So I told myself, maybe before I go into that, I better have just a little reflection on the Millennium Development Goals themselves, just in case our students had never seen them. They would tell me in more university that we don't even know what you're doing. We are dealing with our own curriculum. What are these Millennium Development Goals that we have set for all of us in the year 2000? The first one was eradication of extreme poverty and hunger. And I want to, as I reflect on these Millennium Development Goals, I want to relate them to the issue of women, which is the theme of our conference. We do know that extreme poverty and hunger are actually associated so much with women to the extent that we have had papers written that poverty and hunger actually have the face of a woman. And we know that the main reason here is particularly because, especially in the developing world, you find that most single parents are women. And in Kenya in particular, 40% of the households are run by single women who earn very little, and therefore they fall actually within the category of that Millennium Development Goal number one, where the international community decided to eradicate. The second one is on achieving universal primary education. In the context of Kenya, in the year 2003, a decision was made that we must have universal primary education to adopt what the United Nations had said. But universal primary education does not necessarily mean universal free primary education. If it is not free, and you are talking of Millennium Development 1, that recognizes that there are people who are at the level of extreme poverty and hunger, then you will not be able to achieve that unless you deal with Millennium Development Goal 1. The third Millennium Development Goal that was set at that time was promoting gender equality and empowerment of women. Why is it that? It's because, again, in Millennium Development 1, the recognition is that poverty is really linked with women, and so we must look for a way in which we empower women economically and look for a way in which we can equalize the gender so that everybody has a right, because when you go to the shop to buy sugar, you go to the shop to buy your clothes, everybody pays tax. And if everybody pays tax, then there should be an equal way in which the same tax is used to develop both gender. So there is a need for laws to be put in place to implement this kind of promotion of gender equality. But remember, and I'll show you the Kenyan context, that the same women are not actually in the policy making positions or the legislative positions. So again, that's another, it was a challenge, but one wonders whether the right formula was given. The fourth Millennium Development Goal is that of reducing child mortality rates. And again, this has a lot to do with the mother herself, because we know that there are children that we lose before they are born, and there are children that are lost at birth. So if we had to reduce the child mortality rate, then you must deal with the mother, the woman again. And then in the fifth Millennium Development Goal, it is dealing with improving maternal health care. Yes, that is the only way you can deal with Millennium Development Goal 4, actually, because unless you improve the mother's health, then the child mortality may also go back. The majority of rural women of the world continue to die at childbirth, and the figures are enormous if you look at them in the per country, in fact, in the internet, for those that would have more interest on that. The sixth Millennium Development Goal is that of combating HIV and AIDS, malaria, and other diseases. Again, women happen to be victims of the same, basically, again, because they have no control over a number of issues, including their own lives. The number of partners they have can be influenced by their husbands, and that has another challenge. The seventh one is on ensuring that environmental sustainability. On that, ensuring environmental sustainability, if you look at the developing world, Kenya included, it's very interesting to note that women are actually closer to the environment than men. In Kenya, 80% of the human labor is in the agricultural sector. And this sector, 60% of the workers, 60% of the 80% are actually women. So they are the ones who are handling that. And when it comes to the environmental factors like water, trees, and so forth, actually for women to run their families, they must fetch water from the same source where they take their livestock and they harvest firewood, not to destroy the forest, but to be able to cook for their families. So they are more in touch. The eighth development goal is developing global partnerships for development. When you look at the eight Millennium Development Goals, you find that seven out of the eight are actually goals that would have been used to eradicate issues that we are touching on women. The questions that we need to ask ourselves therefore are, how were these Millennium Development Goals going to be achieved? And I will touch on how Kenya has approached a few of them, then we see some of the paradoxes in which a goal has been set that is supposed to be solving an issue that touches an individual who is not part of the decision. And this is where the greatest challenge comes in the Millennium Development Goals as there. It is therefore imperative that if women are the main subjects of the Millennium Development Goals, the only way they could be achieved is if the women issues are handled properly. I want to say that was the setting of the Millennium Development Goals was in the year 2000, and that these Millennium Development Goals were given a deadline of 15 years, which is next year. How far have the countries done? How far have the family of the nations of the United Nations performed? I will be touching a little bit on Kenya. Now, if that is the case, therefore, then we need to ask ourselves, where in this are the women? I want to look at women in education and their potential impact on the Millennium Development Goals themselves. Education changes the life of everybody. We recently lost Mandela, a man who said education is the only thing that will make a child of a pauper sit on the same seat with a child of a king. Because both of them became professors, by the way, they will even share the laptops. So education transforms. And if you look at education and how it have addressed these Millennium Development Goals, we talk of educated women having the ability to access paying jobs. And we know that if they access paying jobs, they can contribute to poverty reduction and they can deal with Millennium Development Goals directly on themselves or their families. Educated women will also lead healthier lives because they'll be able to access dispensaries, they will be able to access health facilities. So they'll live healthier lives, and the 40% that I was saying, 40% families of single parents that are led by women in Kenya, and I know there are similar figures in other countries, it would then mean that an educated woman will not only live a healthier life for herself, but also for the family, or will affect the family to live a healthier life. Educated girls are more capable of making their own decisions. And when we talk of educated girls making their own decisions, this part of the world may not be having the problems that the developing world has. Because the decisions that an educated girl is required to make are many in Kenya and in other development countries, right from who to marry, when to marry, how to marry. Because we still have the stories of forced marriage, we have early marriage, we have inherited related marriages. These are decisions you cannot make if you are a victim of everybody, including your own family, because you are the weaker person and you cannot make your personal decision. But education frees the woman from that kind of bondage. That will still touch also on the fourth Millennium Development Goal of HIV and AIDS, because education frees you to make your personal decisions. Education is also a deterrent to early marriage, and in rural communities, like we still have rural communities, however much the government of Kenya has tried to ban early marriage before 18, it is very, very tricky to implement it in areas that are far from the central part of the country, basically because families become the deciding factors. But education frees a woman from that. Education also makes both girls and women self-reliant, and they can access better jobs and make choices for themselves. Women in low-income communities are more in touch with the environment, as I said earlier, and any education of such a woman will actually create a transformation not only of the environment where they live in, but even of the family environment itself. Educated women also form the critical mass, that's an incomplete statement, they form the critical mass from where we can get the elected women, the women that can go into policy decision positions, or women who can who can go into leadership positions, because we know that some of the decisions, however much they're internationalized, must be implemented locally. And if you don't have the critical number of women to be taken to those positions, it becomes very difficult. I'll give you an example of Kenya also on that one. And then no country, I dare say, can actually achieve development without the participation of women in society and in governance. Basically because these women are about 50% of the population. Somehow God has a way of balancing how it is balanced, such that every country has 50% women, 50% men, without anybody making a decision, can only tell us that there is a way the gods are doing it. And it is impossible to make any difference unless it is being, unless everybody is involved. So when it comes to the Millennium Development Goals, the big question that I've always asked myself is, if they implemented away from the very people who are the victims of the Millennium Development Goals, then who is going to be, then how is it going to be implemented? At the point of identifying the Millennium Development Goals, you find that a lot of thought was put to identify real issues that were global issues, issues of the century. But today, as we are talking, they are still being discussed. We should be hearing that 90% of these Millennium Development Goals have been sorted out because next year is the deadline. But why is it very far from that? I dare say it is because, again, of lack of involvement of the key people who are going to be affected by that. Now, what are the challenges in Kenya? The challenges faced by women in education and development in relation to the Millennium Development Goals. Let's look at women in education. I want to use figures that have come from our Bureau of Standards. As I mentioned earlier, free primary education, universal primary education was implemented in Kenya in the year 2003, and that had a lot of positive impact because enrollment in primary schools rose very rapidly. So that today we are talking of primary enrollment being at 82% for boys and 83% for girls. So it means everybody goes to school at the primary school almost. The 8 to 7% that we are seeing are basically in the rural areas and particularly the pastoralistic areas. And in fact, the 1% of boys more than girls that are not in school are basically because of doing the herding of animals in these pastoral areas. It was possible to explain that from the figure that I received. And then in the secondary school, however, there's something very worrying, because in the secondary school enrollment, we have 51% of boys and 48% for girls, which means the transition from the primary to the secondary school is almost 50%. That is extremely worrying, because we are busy asking ourselves now in Kenya where these dropouts of grade 8 are. Now, let me say the primary education in Kenya is 8 years, and the secondary education is 4 years. Basic education is supposed to be the 12 years. But because they have been split into two, you find that we have an exam period after class 8, grade 8, and they exit to a secondary school. Sometimes we think we should scrap that transition point, because it seems to attract people or parents that a child has a certificate at grade 8, and that makes them feel as though they have completed something. And yet really, you will find that these dropouts are the ones that we are offloading to the Millennium Development Goal 1, the group that are within the poverty, below the poverty line, and cannot raise an earning for themselves. So that is one challenge that we are currently facing, the transition between the primary to the secondary school. But the university, and I've given you just the desegregated data, but the transition to the university also has another challenge, because of the 5148, which is about 50% of the population that has left primary school, we only took about 20% now. 10% until last year. And last year, I was privileged as the Minister for Higher Education to have worked with our president then on expanding higher education. And we were able to increase the universities in Kenya from 7 universities in a population of over 40 million to 15 universities, to 22 universities. We opened 15 new universities to capture this population. And still, even when we increased that, that only took us to 20% of those who are exiting from the secondary schools. University admission in the disaggregated data gives you 63% of males and 37% of females. That is in the year 2010, 2011, and I've also given you figures of 2012, 2013, where the males are 64 and the females are 36. Again, there is something that is worrying there. The thing that is worrying there is that while in primary school and secondary school, you find that there is almost parity between the girls and the boys. When they go to the university, there is a major dropout from the girls. And this, again, is another challenge that we are faced with, because then it reduces the percentage of women that we are talking of as the women that should be able to solve the problems that are in the Millennium, within, captured in the Millennium Development Goals. Extra admission has been provided by the private universities and privately sponsored programs in the other universities' figures. I've not given you that. Now, what happens in the development area? In the development area, we have women in development, which you can actually, which is a reflection of the employment pattern in the country. And I wanted to give you just a glimpse of what our public service, our employment pattern is. In the public service in Kenya, we have 69.1% male employees and 30.9% female employees. Now, should be noted very seriously is the fact that of those 30.9 female employees, 72% of the women are actually employed in the lower cadres. Lower cadres being the sweeping, the cleaning, the secretarial services, and clerks and so forth, while only 28% of the 30.9% are actually within the senior positions. And then in the government parastatals, and government parastatals are these government companies, as all of you know, we have 60.8% male and 30.2% female. Again, the same pattern when it comes to who is actually, where the women actually are. You will find that the majority of them are within the lower cadre. Under local government, we have women occupy 10% positions in the management and 76% in the lower cadres. So that leaves you, that takes 86%, and the little balance is within the senior positions. In governance, women are 22% in the Kenya Parliament, 30% in the county assemblies, thanks to the new constitution that has made a demand that not more than 2/3 of any elective and appointed position should be held by one gender. In the county assemblies, it is very explicit in the constitution. But in as far as the parliament is concerned, that was not done. We have affirmative action going on, but the affirmative action does not reach the mark of 30%. And then we have 30% in the cabinet, again, thanks to a president who was ready to obey that rule. The importance of this kind of figures is that it tells you where women are and how they can affect the policies and decisions that go with fulfilling the Millennium Development Goals. So that when you start analyzing, and I think reports are coming from, as we are sitting now, there is the CSW is going on in New York, the the Commission on the Status of Women is going on, and I believe the report of Kenya is this, because that is, those are the figures that we have, and most of the other countries are going to look at that. But who can actually touch the real issue that may have led to where we are? Those are questions for academicians to look at. Achievements in Kenya have been done, however, to some extent, as far as women are concerned. One of them is the Constitution of Kenya 2010, which has clearly stated that everybody is equal without discrimination. Freedom from discrimination has been assured for both males and females. Implementation is another longer story, as we are starting to see, but that is a great achievement that it has actually been written inside the Constitution itself. One other article talks about affirmative action to clear the way for the two-thirds rule, that no more than two-thirds of any appointive or elective positions to be should be held by one gender. Again, we are busy trying to work on how that is being implemented. In some sectors, it's working. In some sectors, it's not working. And I want to say that one of the major problems that we are having is what is being reflected by the education itself. Because if the percentage of women who are going through the university are about 30%, then it means that even at the point when appointments are taking place, it may be difficult to fetch the kind of person that you want. There are sectors where women have been very slow in coming up, engineering sectors, so you will not expect them in parastatals that are leaning towards engineering. You will not be able to find them in areas that are heavily on the science sector. And for that reason, Kenya is actually in a program with, one of the West African Francophone countries and the UNESCO to ensure that science teaching for girls is encouraged. So affirmative action, having the laws is one thing, it's an achievement, but implementation is the challenge currently. And then we also have affirmative action initiatives that have been put in place by government, again towards the Millennium Development, fulfillment of the Millennium Development Goals. One is that we have grants for self-help women groups and Women Enterprise Fund. It was given by government from the year 2007. We have cash transfer for the elderly. It is social welfare. I think you have a welfare program here, social welfare, which touches on both women and men. Incidentally, in this figure, you will find that you have more women. For reasons that nobody knows in Kenya, women have a longer lifespan than men. I don't know where what really happens, but those figures show that is true. And then cash transfer for orphans and vulnerable groups is another affirmative action that has enabled orphans, and in particular, you are orphan and you are female, you get more points, and they've been able to go to school using different kinds of bursaries and cash transfers for their protection. The initial cash transfer, in fact, was targeting children orphaned by HIV/AIDS, and we are comfortable now that the victims of HIV and AIDS, those are the orphans, are now being taken care of by government very well. So that is another very good achievement. And then there's campaigns against early marriage. As I said, it has been criminalized to marry or to marry off a girl who is less than 18 years old. And yet, the tricky part is that we still have communities that believe that that should be positive, because you give away your daughter so that you get a few more animals to educate your son and hope for a better future for the family through the son. There are also campaigns against gender-based violence and female circumcision. In conclusion, what do I want to say? Women remain a key critical factor in the achievement of the Millennium Development Goals. However way we look at the Millennium Development Goals, it touches women more than anybody else in society, And if we want the society to change, we must start dealing with the issues that touch women and change the issues that touch women. Strategies should therefore take women issues seriously for meaningful success. And the UN Women Executive Director opening remarks at the CSW some 3 days ago, I just went through the internet, said something I completely concur, that the widespread and persistent gender inequalities in different states, in different nations of the United Nations are holding back the progress for everybody. Because until we deal with those inequalities, even if it is an inequality as basic as accessing health, when a woman does not access health, her suffering makes the whole family suffer. When a woman does not access education, the family she's running because she's involved in most of the family cores will be put down. And I always like a story that I listened to, and somebody said that an educated young man married an uneducated young girl. It was a story told in Kenya. And one day, their little baby got sick and died. And when they asked what the child died of, they said the child died of diarrhea. When the second child was born, the doctor wanted to know, started being sick. The doctor wanted to know what was going on in this family because the same child was suffering. The child was suffering from the same thing. You know, in Africa, we have everything, including witchcraft, to blame. We don't seem to believe anybody dies. When somebody dies, somebody must be involved in it, and some witchcraft must have been involved. So they thought it was witchcraft, but the doctor said he would like to see what's going on in this family. Only for them to go to the family and discover that, yes, the mother of the family was boiling milk, but not the boiling point. A very simple example of what education means in changing the lives of a family and a community. So even in Kenya, we need to focus more on the women issues, women in education and development, to be able to fulfill the Millennium Development Goals. For the remaining 1 year, all of us must be involved in this, including academicians. Thank you very much, and thank you for listening.